Just in passing, the fact that the shepherds were out on the hills with the sheep, guarding them against wild animals and thieves, meant that Jesus' birth actually took place between April and November. Because that's the only time that the shepherds were out on the hills looking after the sheep. Because during winter, even in Palestine, it gets pretty cold. Christmas wasn't celebrated until the 4th century, 400 years, 300 to 400 years after Jesus' birth. Why was it put on the 25th of December? Well, it had absolutely nothing whatsoever to do with the date that Jesus was born.
The Christmas Story, Part 3. Jesus' Birth by Pastor David Wise is inspired by Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 20. Many have such a Christmas card picture of Jesus' birth that they miss the real significance. In this teaching, Pastor David strips away the myth and tinsel to look at what really took place and asks about what it means for us today.
Father God, we thank you for this season of Christmas when we can think about, reflect on, we can celebrate the reality of your Son Jesus being born into our world. Father God, as we look at your word this morning, as we talk together, as we share together, ask that you're going to speak to us. Father, even though this story is familiar, I want to ask that this morning we don't just gain a bit more information, we have some revelation from yourself. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I hope Christmas is going well for you. Well, there are four people in the front row for whom it's going well for. Let's see a bit further back. I hope Christmas is going well for you. That's good. Excellent. Well, we've been, we're partway through a five-part seasonal series that Warren and I are sharing together. We're having a break next week. Next week is a baptismal service next week. If you're thinking about being baptized, want to start the new year with being baptized, next week is an opportunity. Vanessa's being baptized next week. But there's space for others as well. So if that's something you're thinking about, you might want to talk to me afterwards. So we're not continuing next week, but in 2 weeks' time, we'll be part four, and in 3 weeks' time, we'll be part five. Now, last week, Warren was doing the teaching, and you will remember, who was here last week? I'm sure there are a few more of you than that here last week, but I'm glad you were here last week. If you were here last week, you would have heard Warren talking about the angel Gabriel's announcement to Mary. Do you remember that? Does it ring any bells? Mary's response to that? Can you remember, those of you who were here last week, or others of you who are just very clever, what the key things that we learned last week were? What were the key things we learned last week when we looked at that story together? There was something about being blessed and highly favoured, I recall. Can you remember what it was? Puzzled expressions, scratching of noses, prodding of ears, hand in the air. Well, let's go and investigate.
Yeah, I think one of the things that stuck with me was that even though you might be blessed and highly favoured, in human terms, that might not necessarily look like good news.
Yes. Well, good news in that just because you're blessed and highly favoured doesn't mean that life is going to be really easy. So here it was for Mary. Yeah, blessed and highly favoured meant that she was pregnant before she got married, which socially was not good news. So yeah, blessed and highly favoured doesn't mean an easy life. There was something else we learned about trusting God as well last time. Can you remember what Warren brought out so clearly from that passage about trusting God?
I don't know if this is what you meant or not, but I was comparing it with Zechariah, whose the pronouncement was kind of, how can this be, you know, you must be joking type stuff, and God was not just very pleased with that, and he got struck being dumb. But Mary was, how will this be? It seemed to me a faith statement, but she'd like to know more. And God blessed her for that. There wasn't any kind of punishment for that. And I was actually struck when from that I carried on reading and looked at Joseph's response, which seemed to be utter acceptance and going and doing what he needed to do without any questioning at all. I was quite amazed at those three responses.
So the trust in God, you're pretty close on the mark there. All you've said is absolutely correct. The other thing that Warren brought out last week, that trusting God actually means serving him. It affects the way we live our lives. It affects the things that we do. It's not just some mental, theoretical statement. It actually affects the things that we do. So that sets the background for the passage we're going to look at today, which is Luke chapter 2. We're looking at the first 20 verses. We're looking at Jesus' birth today, Luke chapter 2, and we're going to be looking together at the first 20 verses. Now, those of you who are in the teaching that I do know that I ask questions as I go through. And I want to warn you that there is a sting in the tail, because I've got three questions that I'm going to finish with this morning. So there might not be so many questions early on, but that doesn't mean that you're going to get it easy, because we're going to work together. Amen? The people at the front are far more responsive this morning than the people in the middle and at the back. So that means we're going to work together. Amen?
Amen?
Yeah, I think I need to go and look them in the eye when I ask the questions. I'm watching you, okay? Luke chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. Now, Caesar Augustus became ruler of the Roman world in the year that we now call 27 BC. Of course, it wasn't called 27 BC when he became emperor, because you can't date the years before Jesus was born before he was born. You see what I mean? So that's why I say it later became called 27 BC. And the purpose of the census was that the Romans wanted to sort out the poll tax. Yeah, some of you remember we had a poll tax in this country. Very unpopular move. So wanted to sort out the poll tax and also wanted to sort out military conscription. Though Jews were exempt from military prescription, but it wasn't the case for others. So that was the whole point of the census, was to get the poll tax sorted. You can boo, that's all right. And military conscription. So verse 4. Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them at the inn. Now, Emperor Augustus, in common with the other Roman emperors, had a rather high opinion of themselves. In fact, they thought they were God. And in fact, that the you know, we have this phrase that we use, Jesus is Lord. In those days, it was politically very subversive. Because if you were a Roman citizen, you were expected to say, Caesar is Lord. And so the Christians wouldn't do that. And that's another story, which for another time. But they had a very strong, very high opinion of themselves. They believed they ran the world. In fact, they believed they ran the universe. But here's the amazing thing. I'm not going to read it now, but Micah chapter 5, verse 2 prophesies, God's word talks about this event that's taking place here. So here is Augustus, who believed he was God, thought he was running the universe, actually doing God's will. Because this decree got Joseph and Mary to the place where Jesus was to be born, as prophesied many hundreds of years before in Micah, what's now Book of Micah, chapter 5 and verse 2. So it just reminds us that people who think they're big who think they're important, who think they're above everybody else, aren't immune from God's influence. They can find themselves doing God's will without realizing it, because God is actually the one that's in charge, and it is God who is running the universe. So Jesus is born and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now at that time, in homes in Palestine, the houses were ordered on basically on two levels. The family slept upstairs, and downstairs the animals slept. It was the barn, effectively. Downstairs with the family, upstairs. And the point here, and we'll come back to this later on, the point here was that the only available room for Jesus was with the animals. And so he's placed in a feeding trough, and we'll come back to that a little bit later on. Verse 8, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Now, there's something very odd about these verses. I mean, you're familiar, and we sing the song about while shepherds watch their flocks by night, all seated on the ground, angel of the Lord came down and glory. I mean, you're all familiar with that. But there's something really, really odd, almost a bit dysfunctional about this. Because shepherds actually were generally despised in those days. And yet God chose only to announce the birth to shepherds and to some wise men who were a long way away. They don't arrive for another 2 to 3 years, but mentions it over there. So your Christmas cards with wise men and shepherds in the picture are a bit wrong, because they weren't there at the same time. But that's a story perhaps for another day. Shepherds were despised. They had very low social standing. They were specifically, and this is interesting, they were specifically banned from giving evidence in court because shepherds were considered to be so unreliable. And yet, these are the only people chosen by the angel to get this message. Now, let's try and move that into West London in 2013. Now, we don't have shepherds on Horsenden Hill or any of the other surrounding hills. So, who do you think the social equivalent in Greenford, Northolt, Southolt, in this area, who would be the social equivalent today of the shepherds? Who do you think they might be?
Possibly two groups, either addicts or migrants, immigrants, refugees.
Okay, yeah. I could think of some others as well who I think would be in that category.
The homeless.
Homeless, yeah. Anybody else? I think there are some others around who might be in that category today.
We've heard in the news quite recently about the Roma people that nobody wants.
Yeah. Yeah. I think also of some people perhaps living locally who might have living rough might have mental health problems, people who may be alcoholics, sleeping in the street, those sort of people who would be perhaps outside, who would be considered, you know, someone who's using drugs or an alcoholic, and they say, oh, I saw some angels. You're not going to give that a huge amount of credit, are you? Their evidence is not going to be taken terribly seriously. So, that's the first question. Here's the second question. What does it tell us about God that the only people he announced the birth to at the time were people that society despised and considered to be completely unreliable? What does that tell us about God?
Bible says about God, my thoughts are not your thoughts and my ways are not your ways. He's got a totally different slant on things from us.
Okay, so he's got a totally different slant. I mean, if we wanted to announce something and get it well known, we'd pick some pretty reliable people, wouldn't we? People with social esteem, maybe people with big followings on Twitter, or, you know, lots of likes on Facebook. These are the people that we would choose to announce something to if we wanted it to be well known. But God's got a different agenda. So what's God's agenda? Why pick some of the most despised and unreliable people around? What's that about?
By doing so, he's inclusive. Nobody can say, it can't be good news for me, because if it's good news for, in a sense, the lowest of the low, then it's good news for everybody.
Yeah, it's inclusive. Something else as well. There's a big clue at the front of the church. If you've not actually managed to catch it yet, there is a large clue at the front of the church.
I was going to say God teaching us the way he loves, not the way we know love. Different kind of love.
Yeah, different kind of love. Anybody spot the large clue at the front of the church? Good news to the poor. When Jesus began his ministry, he said, I have come to bring good news to the poor. So God announces the good news that Jesus has come to the poor. Do you remember that when we looked at that earlier this year, poor is not just about economic position and wealth. It is about social status and standing. The poor were the people who were beyond, the people who were outside of the margins. They were the people right at the periphery of society. They were the people that were unacceptable. And Jesus said, I've come to bring good news to the poor. Which is why here, God, with his very different agenda, he announces the good news only to the poor and some kings a long way away. Well, wise men they were actually, not kings. Wise men a long way away. Isn't that amazing? You see, when we look at this story, and we'll come back to this in a few moments, we clean the story up a bit. You know, when your shepherds on your Christmas cards, they look pretty smart, don't they? In fact, they look like they've just been kitted out at some nice boutique in really nice shepherd clothes. Spotless, clean, smiling, and generally white as well. None of those things would have been true of them, including the fact that they weren't white. They would have been smelly and dirty, in some pretty messy clothes. Pretty unkempt. Just in passing, the fact that the shepherds were out on the hills with the sheep, guarding them against wild animals and thieves, meant that Jesus' birth actually took place between April and November. Because that's the only time that the shepherds were out on the hills looking after the sheep. Because during winter, even in Palestine, it gets pretty cold. Christmas wasn't celebrated until the 4th century, 400 years, 300 to 400 years after Jesus' birth. Why was it put on the 25th of December? Well, it had absolutely nothing whatsoever to do with the date that Jesus was born. The Emperor Constantine had become a Christian. And he decided that he wanted to try and Christianize various festivals. And there was taking place in December the festival of Saturnalia. And so, which celebrated the return of the sun after increasing darkness. And it was a big event that all people took part in, and they gave presents to one another as well. Does that sound familiar? So he decided, rather than trying to ban it, he would Christianize it. So right next to it, not on the same day, just a few days later, he put this new festival called Christmas to celebrate the birth of Jesus and when people could give presents to one another. So that's how we ended up with Christmas being celebrated on the 25th of December. Nothing whatsoever to do with the date of Jesus' birth, which will be somewhere between April and November. It's not the only thing we do around Christmas that's got nothing to do with the original events, but we might leave a few of those for another day as well. Verse 13. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When you hear that word angel, I wonder what image is conjured up in your mind. What, you know, when you're picturing it, what do you see in your mind when you think about angels? Anybody want to tell us?
Someone like us. As in someone who looks like us.
Okay. Anybody else?
Well, I have an image of a messenger, because all the messages given to people in the Bible are brought by angels.
So they're messengers. Anything else? Anything? Any other bits about them?
I've always thought Gabriel must have been 9 feet tall and glowed from Joseph's reaction. I mean, from,
There was something about them that was frightening, because nearly always their first words are, "Do not be afraid." And I reckon, you know, if someone looking like Steve Williams turned up, we probably wouldn't be afraid. But there's something about these angels when they appear that actually is a bit frightening. So maybe they were 9 foot tall. Maybe Steve Williams, if he does turn up, is... Anyway, let's not go there.
Always sort of knee-jerk, I always get the Renaissance artists, you know, all big fluffy wings and glowing. But there's been a series on the TV on Channel 4, The Bible, and they've portrayed them more like warriors, you know, in their hoods and cloaks and so on. So I think that would be, for me, probably closer to the truth of these warriors of Christ.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? The fact is, we actually don't know what they look like at all, because the Bible doesn't tell us anywhere. Just that it's always, do not be afraid. And you're absolutely right. The word angel actually means, it's a Greek word that we borrowed into English. It's the Greek word angelos, which we brought over into English, and it literally means messenger. And in the New Testament, angels were usually sent by God to bring his word, to explain something that otherwise would be a complete mystery. It's to bring understanding, and they crop up in a number of different situations. Without an explanation, who would know that a baby, newborn, lying in an animal's feeding trough, had come from God? The only way people would know is through a revelation from God. And we do really sanitize this story. I mean, I don't know how many of you have actually been into a working farm, been into the area where the animals live in a working farm. How many of you have been there? Quite a few of you. Yeah, it's a bit smelly, isn't it? Well, it's very smelly, and it's pretty dirty as well, because animals don't wear nappies, do you know what I mean? Pretty unpleasant. Have you ever looked at the feeding trough where the cows and the pigs and the other animals feed? Have you ever looked at it? Is it nice and clean? It's covered in animal slobber, isn't it? Yuck. And animal other stuff as well, if they were facing the wrong way at the... You get the point. Now, into that scene, we get a group of men who've been sleeping out on the hills, who are going to be really smelly, unkempt, rough, pretty rough, probably illiterate. They bundle in as well. Doesn't look an awful lot. I don't think they'd sell many Christmas cards if they had a picture on there what it was really like. We sanitize the story. And because we sanitize the story, we actually miss the power of what is taking place here. Now, if God had wanted Jesus to be born in a nice suite with crisp white linen, big fluffy pillows, he wouldn't have sent him to be born in Bethlehem to two poor people for whom there is nowhere even to go when she's in labor. But God wanted to make a very clear point here. Jesus came to bring good news to the poor. And he was poor. He was born into a poor family. He's born into a race that was oppressed in an occupied territory. Born in a situation that was pretty unhygienic, to put it mildly, was pretty disgusting. That's where God chose for his son to be born. And our sanitized Christmas images just erase all of that. Someone was talking to me the other day. It could be somebody in the congregation here. I don't remember who it was. They were talking about the film, The Passion of the Christ. And they'd watched it, and they just talked about, they thought that, they were talking about the crucifixion, the scene where Jesus, first of all, is flogged and then crucified. And they talked about how they thought it was, the gore was overdone. The fact is, if they showed it as it was, it wouldn't have got a certificate at all. The gore is not overdone. You read an account of what took place when someone was flogged and crucified. See, we sanitize all of that. We forget the horrible, grim reality of Jesus being born and living and dying. God chose to do that for you and for me. God chose to have his son, the creator and sustainer of the whole of the universe, born to a teenager, unmarried, in a poor family, to an oppressed people, in a place where animals lived, not even a bed, not even a cot, just some straw, in a pretty filthy feeding trough. And brought along to witness the event some of the most despised, smelly, unreliable ruffians you could find. Why? Because Jesus came to be good news for the poor. Good news for the poor. The angel's message was, don't be afraid, be joyful, because God has sent the Messiah who is Savior. Actually, it's quite good to remind ourselves at this time of year why Jesus came. It wasn't so we could have Christmas pudding and mince pies. Why did Jesus come? What was that about? He's Saviour. What did he come to save us from? This is an easy question, not a trick question. But it's just good to remind ourselves why he came. Why he came as Saviour. What's he saving? Who's he saving from what? Do put your hand up and I'll rush to you. Or walk slowly, one or the other.
Come to save us from our sins.
What does the word sin mean?
Sin is when you do things wrong and you know that you're doing it wrong, but you still do it. To me, that's sin.
Okay, so he came to save us from the things that we've done wrong. And to save us because those things separate us from God, don't they? The things that we do wrong separate us from God. And Jesus came to make it possible for us to have those things that we do wrong forgiven and to find relationship with God, to find relationship with our Heavenly Father. That's why he came. That's why Christmas is good news. And he talks about, the angels talk about, they use this phrase, Lord, it's used there in verse 11, Christ the Lord. And that word Lord there is the usual term to describe God. And after that announcement, huge company of angels all around, they're singing, glory to God on the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favour rests. What does that phrase, peace to men on whom his favour rests, what is that about? What does that mean? We live in a world now, don't we, which is full of conflict. I mean, when you listen to the news, even at this time of year, you know, in the news this week, you've got the conflict in Sudan. Huge numbers of people dying there. We have the conflict in Syria. We have conflict in Egypt. We have more deaths in Israel and the Gaza. Wherever you look around the world, there is conflict of one sort or another. And yet, here, Jesus came to bring peace on earth to men on whom his favour rests. What does that mean? We sing it in the carols. We have these phrases, but sometimes we don't quite grasp what they're about. Doug?
I think it's a restoration of the relationship that we were to have with God from the beginning, and we talk about sins as something we do, but actually we're already a sinner before we sin, and we are separated and broken, and our first restoration is with God, and then it comes with other people too. And I think this is the kind of peace that he's talking about, that you have consolation of soul and you have the ability to commune with God and to know him and to experience his love.
So the first part of peace that Jesus came to bring was peace between us as individuals and God, because there is a Bible talks about an enmity there because of the things that we've done wrong. The fact that we are sinners and we sin means that there is separation between us and God. So to bring peace there. And then you talked about the fact that that spills out, if you like, into other relationships. Let's explore that a bit. So peace between us as individuals and God. How does that then bring peace wider in our world? How does that work? What does that mean? I see those hands and they're all at the back. I'll be back to you in a moment. Let me go around over here.
Yes, Pastor David. Once we find the peace with God, God then restores our heart so that then we can find peace with people who we may have difficult relationships. If I could just give you a quick example.
A quick example.
Yeah, man, really quick. Is that, as you probably know, black sheep and all that, and my mum and I went through years of difficult relationship. But since becoming a Christian, I've forgiven myself, I've forgiven her, and she phones me on a regular basis. So that's because of the peace that I found through God, and she found through God as well. So there's a form of peace right there.
So because you found peace with God, you've now found peace with your mother in what was a really broken relationship. Yeah, amen. Thank you.
I was going to say about the same thing, like when, because God has forgiven us, that makes it obligatory for us to forgive other people and stop holding things against, and then we feel lighter and at peace, sort of, yeah.
Excellent, thank you. And I saw another hand over here. Ah.
Yeah, I think peace between people or nations is an outflow of the inflow of God making peace with us. I think before God makes peace with us, we are naturally self-protective and focused inwardly. Whereas when he makes peace with us and we're secure with him, it enables us to be more outward towards other people because we're not trying to be self-protective all the time.
Excellent. So this peace between us and God, that then affects relationships with family, it affects other people around us, and finally?
We become peacemakers, because within us is God's Spirit, and where he places us, we become people of peace, planting seeds of peace in people's lives, and in some cases in countries as well. We've got people who are restoring countries because of where they are.
Fantastic. Thank you. Okay, let's come to these last few verses, which is where I want to spend a chunk of time this morning. So when the angels had left them, verse 15, and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they'd seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherd said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Now these five verses have three responses. And I want us to think about what those responses look like in practice for us today. So the first one you find in verse 18. All who heard it were amazed. All who heard it, so that's all the people round about who heard about what had taken place, they were amazed. What do you think that looks like if that was happening in December 2013 or January 2014 here? All who heard it were amazed. What does that response look like? What does it mean? I see people mulling. That's it. Mulling, that's the idea. Get you thinking. That's the first time I'm going to ask this same question three times with three different responses. So, this will be going.
Well, if you hear something amazing, you want to talk about it. So the equivalent, I think, today would be Facebook, Twitter, and just general conversation. It would be in all the papers, on all the television. Everybody would be talking about it.
Okay, so it's something that lots of people are talking about. They're tweeting. Is that Andy, is that the right word? Excellent. My wife says she's gradually dragging me into the 20th century. I've got a little way to go till I get into the 21st, but I'm actually gradually being dragged into the 20th.
Yeah, I mean, social media would go mad, but the amazement would be that this just doesn't compute. It doesn't actually make any sense. It doesn't fit how you would expect this to be. But that's what's so authentic about it. That if you're going to dress it up, you would tell an accountant or a, sorry, Barry, or an important person, a socially important person, because they would be credible. So what do? To make it authentic, you tell somebody who wouldn't be credible. But all the talk would be, well, why hasn't this happened in the palace? Or why hasn't this happened here? Why hasn't this happened there? And there would just, the amazement is almost confusion rather than, isn't this wonderful?
Some of these things that, shall I go viral? Yeah, look, see, I'm learning the language. Or things that are trending on Twitter. Oh, yeah, come on. I got a crib sheet here. So, all of these things, does anything actually change? And the answer is often absolutely nothing. There is fascination, there is wow, but no understanding of what has really taken place, and no lasting change. Because 2 days later on Twitter, something else is trending, and something else is being watched on YouTube, and it's all moved on, and nothing has changed. The lead story on the papers, it's something else the next day. Fascination, amazement, no real understanding, or lasting change. And that's one of the ways that people can respond to the Christian message. Wow, that's amazing. What's for dinner? Just moving on without actually any lasting change. Verse 19 is a second response. Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. What does that response mean, and what does that look like? Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart.
Well, she'd been leading up to this for 9 months since she saw the angel, her angel. But it gives the impression that although it was wonderful and the baby was there, she really didn't understand it. She really still didn't understand it.
Okay. Any other thoughts?
In her case, I would have called a few people, but she preferred to keep it to herself and wait and see first before she said something that was wrong, you know, like that didn't fit with it or something, yeah.
Okay. Anything else?
It feels like she's storing up memories. That she believes what the shepherds told her they saw, and she is storing these things for thinking about. I don't know. It's like treasure. It's like she's treasuring them all to remember what God has done.
Okay, so she's sort of storing it away, thinking about it, considering it. She's still looking for understanding because she doesn't actually understand at this point what is going on. Okay, let's look at the final one. It's in verse 17 and in verse 20, and it's the shepherds glorifying and praising God. What does this mean, and what does this look like in practice today? The shepherds glorifying and praising God. What does that mean? What does it look like?
like the song says, I got to tell somebody, I got to tell somebody.
Okay, so they've become the first evangelists, haven't they, effectively? They are just telling everyone about it. Okay, yeah, what else?
My Jewish law's not so hot, but I don't think that they were clean. So I don't think they were allowed to be in the temple place glorifying and praising God. And so they were taking God back to where they were allowed to be. And I guess that's more about the evangelizing, but it's also that they had a right. God had given them that right.
Yes, because God had accepted them, because God had chosen them to receive the message. And so you're right, they would have been unclean. They wouldn't have been allowed in the temple. But here they are, not in the temple, outside, on the hills, around, glorifying and praising God. Yeah, what else?
To use your initial Twitter viral type thing, it's rather than just being the wow, what's for dinner, it suggests, it's a response that suggests some more fundamental change that's going on in them, that they're actually recognising that this is God at work here, as opposed to, oh, isn't this interesting? So it just said it's a response that suggests that there is something of more depth going on in them, and they're actually now pointing in the direction towards where everything's coming from, i.e. God.
Absolutely. We don't know what happened to the shepherds subsequently. It doesn't form in the gospel story. But the indication here is that there is something of fundamental change. They were obedient to God's word. God said to them, go, and they went. They could have said, you're having a laugh. They could have said, I'm quite warm cuddled up here on this hill. But no, they actually were obedient to something that was fairly balmy. Go and find a baby. You'll recognize him because he's in a feeding trough. What? But they listened to God. They're obedient to God's word. They gave God all the honor and all the worship due to him and told everyone they met about what they'd witnessed and about what it meant. Now, here's something for you to think about, whether you're watching this on the internet subsequently or whether you're here this morning. What is your response to the reality of Jesus' birth? Is it, wow, that's amazing, what's for dinner? Is it, oh, that's really interesting, that's so deep, really, really deep. I need to think about that and consider it and mull it over and wonder. Or is it, I'm going to do what God says. I'm going to be obedient and responsive to him because this is amazing. There is a God who loves me. There is a God who cares about me. There is a God who's good news for the poor. There is a God who asks me not just to trust him, but to serve him. So I'm going to do it. I'm going to be obedient to God. I wonder what your response is. For those of you who are here who have not yet been baptized, I wonder where you are. Are you at that, wow, this is a really interesting story, what's for dinner? Or, well, that's so deep, I'm still thinking that over and pondering it. And are you at the place where, yeah, this is God. He's done this for me. He says to me, as a part of my finding faith in him, that I need to be baptized. Well, next Sunday is an opportunity for that. For you. So four things as we draw together the material from this morning. Four things that I want to underline. God is at work even when people aren't aware of it. So there is Caesar, who thought a lot of himself, actually finding he's serving the living God that he probably never noticed. Second, God cares about those whom society doesn't value. You know, if Jesus was being born in Greenford in 2013, think about who he'd be announcing the birth to. And they're the people that God really cares about. Not that he doesn't care for all, but God is biased towards the poor, the outcast, the marginalized. The Saviour has come. Jesus is here, bringing peace into our world, into our lives, that spreads out into our relationships and into wider society. But finally, being amazed is not enough. We should be people who do God's will. I'd invite you to stand. We're coming to an end of our time this morning. I'm going to be quiet for a moment. I've been talking for the last 50 and a bit minutes. So I'd like you to stand together, if you're able to. And I want to invite you, if there's something you want to say to God this morning, some response you want to make to him, this is your opportunity to do that now. I'm going to be silent, and then I will lead us in prayer in a couple of minutes' time. Father God, thank you that you sent Jesus into our world. And thank you that you chose to announce that, not to the rich and privileged, but to the marginalized, the despised. Thank you that you care for all people. Thank you for the news of peace, that you want to bring peace into people's lives, peace between you and them, and peace between us and people around us, in our families, in our community. Father God, thank you. Father, help us to be people who aren't just amazed, who don't just turn it over in our minds, but people who are obedient to your words, doing what you want us to do, serving you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.